Hi, I'm Sean Diddy, and we are going to be together for about 45 minutes today talking about how you can earn your master's degree either on campus or online in consciousness and human potential. And this isn't just about earning a degree. If you're here and you're just interested in the idea of consciousness and human potential, maybe you've been reading some of the important journals based on organizational behavior, or even those magazine articles or the emails that come to your inbox talking about emotional intelligence, emotions in the workplace, stress in the workplace, the great resignation, how to make the most out of your career, how to become an entrepreneur. These are all things that we can talk about today because they all come back to consciousness. And we have experts with us. We're going to talk about what the MA in consciousness and human potential really goes into. And one of those things a lot of folks ask, you know, who am I? How am I connected to everything around me? Another idea is exploring your inner conscious. So you'll investigate the current perspectives on human potential, but also traditional perspectives. And as I mentioned, a lot of folks are really wanting to study, okay, how does this now fit into my life as things are now? How does this play into being as successful as I can in the workplace, getting promotions, or even becoming an entrepreneur and owning a successful business and managing other people? Also, how does this play into life balance in regard to career, family, maybe your health and wellness routine? We're going to go through how you can do this either on campus. That's a 10-month immersion program in Fairfield, Iowa, on our beautiful 365-acre campus, or you can do it online. And that's a 32-month longer program. It allows you to work, take care of family, maybe your other obligations, but you can also combine that, meaning you can start online, come join us on campus. And we actually have Simone with us, and she has done both online and on campus as a student. So she's going to talk with you about that. Also with us are experts, Keith Wegman. Keith is a professor of Maharishi-based Vedic science, but he also is your contact for the online version of the program. And also Fred Travis, who is the chair of our Department of Maharishi Vedic Science, a world-renowned neuroscientist specialist. He's going to talk with you about the science of the brain and some of the studies he's conducted. Just an idea of what people have done with this degree. We have Kathy graduated, and she is a certified teacher of TM, Transcendental Meditation, and you can learn more about TM. We have Doug, who is an entertainer, but he was a former college communications professor. Margo is now a researcher. Galen is an artist, and he mentioned that he fostered a sense of personal growth. And then Brock is a baseball coach. And that's interesting because he talks about how this consciousness and human potential plays into how he can help to develop his students, his team. And even Johannes, who is now doing the PhD, came from the financial background and talks about how he has learned to relax his physiology and handle stress in high pressure situations. If you have questions about tuition, and we usually get a lot of those questions, I want to tell you that it's easier for you because each situation is a little different. So I can't specifically give you a number right here. It's easier for you to go to miu.edu/financial-aid, and you'll click a few things there. And that way it'll base it on your personal situation, take into account student loans, your financial situation, and it'll give you a ballpark idea. And then if you have specific questions, you can always reach our financial aid department at finaid@miu.edu. This is an accredited university. MIU is accredited by the Higher Learning Commission, so you can pay your tuition with federal student loans. Those cover tuition, housing for folks, meals. Sometimes there's extra for expenses. This is a look at our beautiful campus. We have a lovely reservoir, which isn't pictured there, but just a wonderful community. If you do come to Fairfield, you will see that we are really a campus in a city of 10,000 people that focuses on natural health and wellness. We have organic vegetarian meals in our cafeteria. We'll talk about the fact that everyone, our faculty and our students, practice Transcendental Meditation 20 minutes twice a day. We are a campus with heart, and we'll get more into that as well. If you're wondering where we're located, that red circle in the middle with the arrow is MIU. We're in the center of the United States, about like 5 hours drive from Chicago, 2 hours from Des Moines, Iowa, an hour and a half from Cedar Rapids. We've marked a few of the regional airports as well, giving you an idea of where you might fly into. And again, our admissions team is great about making sure you know how to get to us. This is all about you. So ask your questions, give your comments. If we say something that resonates with you or you want to learn more about it, just comment in the Q&A. The chat is not what we're using today. We're using the Q&A and it's at the bottom of your screen. So feel free to type your question in there. Dr. Wegman, as I mentioned, is going to kick things off. And actually, Dr. Wegman, first off, will you tell us just a little bit about how you got to MIU and what you now do and how you're a part of this program?
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here and welcome to all of you. Long story, I'll try to keep it short. I learned how to meditate when I was in college, and I was a philosophy major, and I was kind of looking into sort of those deep, big questions in life. And the moment I began to practice transcendental meditation and have a really deep, quieting inner experience, at that moment, philosophy began to make sense to me. And it really blew me away. It was a real rich inner experience. And I found out later that there was a university where all the students meditate together. I came down to visit. I lived in Minneapolis at the time, so it wasn't too far away. It's about 5 hours from there. And was just really blown away by the campus, by the people, by the variety, by the emphasis on individual growth, but also on societal development, which really surprised me. So it was really that experience in college that set up the whole thing. And then I sort of did the PhD with an emphasis in Sanskrit. I became a teacher of transcendental meditation because I thought, you know, this is a great way to promote an experience that I really enjoyed. And then eventually caught on with the faculty and just love the department, love all the students that we have. And it's really been a fantastic ride. So happy to be here and really, really happy to talk to anybody that's on the call. So looking forward to it.
And it's fun too, as you get to know the folks that are online with us today. You know, Keith, I know you have teenagers and a dog and a life, and Keith's wife is one of my dearest, most favorite people. So it's fun to see how real life happens to people who are in this program, and yet they seem to remain very calm and steady. And I think part of the reason that I came to MIU was I was like, I want to do what they're doing, whatever that is. Mm-hmm. I want to do that. And Dr. Travis, I know you have been studying the idea of, you know, states of the mind. And because I study organizational behavior, and there are so much right now out there about emotions in the workplace and how we can learn to manage stress, how does your research, and maybe we should start with, how did you get to MIU, and give us a little background about what you do at MIU, and then how that plays into what's happening in the workplace today?
Excellent questions. I think I'll focus mostly on the emotional intelligence, because for many people, that's the deepest part of the whole psychological system. And indeed, we first get an emotional evaluation of the situation, and then we evaluate what the situation is. So emotions are driving our decisions. What we do here at MIU is we even probe further than feelings. We even probe further than the individual self to probe what's our universal basis. Who are we when we're not thinking and acting and doing? And by connecting our thoughts to our universal self, we find that our thoughts have a much broader basis. And that's fundamentally why I came here. I actually have my PhD from MIU in 1988. I came to get my PhD, it was a psychology degree, because I was interested in how people can grow and become the most that they can be. And every other psychology program was very limited. It was development, or it was information processing, or organizational behavior. I wanted to look at the larger structures. So that's why I came here. received my PhD in 88, did a 2-year postdoc in basic sleep research that is looking at the brain to understand why we sleep. And I came back here in 1990 to look at the brain when we're transcending. Sleep is one thing, transcending is different. It leads to a whole new state of consciousness, restful alertness. And by looking at the brain, you get a concrete measure of what's going on in the depths of consciousness.
Thank you. And Simone is with us. And, you know, Simone, as a student, why did you choose this degree and how is it integrating with your life?
Well, like Keith said, long story or short story, let's yes. Well, at a certain point in my life, after being in the workplace for about 3 decades, 30 years, I started thinking that there had to be more to life than what I had been experiencing. So I felt this need to shift gears, right? So I started studying about self-development, and I ended up being instructed in the Transcendental Meditation Technique. After I was instructed, just a few weeks later, I started having experiences which I would not trade for anything with my eyes open. So I was getting more while I was meditating than in my usual experiences. So I have always been very curious and interested to understand how things work. And then I decided that I wanted to understand what was happening in my brain, in my physiology, what was that I was experiencing. So that's my research towards universities and everything. It led me to NYU, and about a year and a half later, I joined the on-campus program.
Well, we have you with us, so we have more questions for you, and I know people are typing those in. And again, if you have questions about the student experience, Simone has graciously offered to answer those for you. So, you know, type them in, let us know what you're thinking, and we'll get more into, I think, the student experience in the community. I do want to post some of the classes, because I think one of the questions that comes up often is, what exactly am I studying? And then we'll talk about how does this apply to where you are in life. And a lot of folks that join us for the MA, you're probably maybe working or have been in the workforce. Maybe you're trying to get into management. So some of the courses, there's physiology, consciousness, and beta, the science of being. We mentioned Sanskrit. These are the core courses. And then we'll get into some of the classes that you can take that are electives. But could you talk maybe, Keith, about the capstone? What does a capstone mean, and how does that help people when they leave this degree?
Very good. Yeah, the capstone is really the culmination of the course. It, in a way, it plays the role of sort of where you produce your master's thesis, in a sense. But it brings together all the knowledge that you study over the 1-year on-campus program or the 2.5 to 3-year online program. It's a synthesis. So you look over, and we often emphasize for students at the end of each course that they take, and you take one course at a time, that's something Sean mentioned. At the end of that course, you sort of collect your biggest thoughts about what you learned. And then you sort of review that at the end of the program, more or less, and then take a particular angle that you're fascinated by in terms of anything really, any subject matter that's covered. And then you develop that into a wonderful personal sort of project that everybody, I think, can be really proud of. So that's the focus of the capstone.
And Dr. Travis, do you consult with students on their capstones? And there are so many areas of your research that are applying to articles that I keep reading in business journals right now. What are you seeing as far as what students are doing with this?
I do work with students that are interested more in the scientific, the objective measure of it. Because by objectively measuring the brain, you get a concrete picture of what might be going on in terms of dealing with stress, in terms of decision-making, in terms of growth of higher states and so on. So the capstone, the students have had all of the faculty throughout the year. And so they very naturally would go to that faculty to ask questions to help them. It's a very collegial spirit.
Thank you. And Simone, do you have a favorite part? Did you do a capstone, or is there a class that comes to mind right away that you want to tell everybody about?
Oh my God, don't ask me that. Wow, where should I start? I mean, capstone was amazing. It was the very last course that I did. And I did a topic which was related to teachers, how to lower stress for the teachers population, and how the Transcendental Meditation Program can support higher states of consciousness, focusing on that population. So this is something that maybe I will have to develop more, maybe in a later course, right? But it was basically about that. And that was a theme that was very close to my heart, because I have been a teacher my whole life. In the corporate world, I used to teach English to businessmen, corporate people, that kind of environment. And I knew, I mean, the stress among teachers in schools, because I also had that experience, and the stress among the population that I was working with. So stress in general was a big topic for me, and I want to explore stress for teachers. Now, regarding the classes, Science of Being was like a joy, you know, to do it, because you connect with your own self. And we explore one of Maharishi's books, which is Science of Being and the Art of Living. And it's like, it's as if he were your personal coach and he were speaking directly to you, you know? So it's like, it would be, I remember our professor, Dr. Agnes, he would ask us to read 20 pages every day, like as homework. So I would wake up and read my 20 pages, and that would, you know, just give a different tone to my day. And it's important to say that I would read in the morning, because we have, we follow when we are at NYU, and we learn to take that to our lives, how to follow an ideal routine, and a daily routine which will support your growth, which will support your joy, your happiness, your personal development, you know? I mean, how to get the most of life by following specific guidelines that will lead you to that. And one of them is go to bed before 10 o'clock. Right, Dr. Travis? I still follow that and I love it. And I mean, Dr. Travis' class was just like amazing. I have learned so much about myself, things that are like so practical, you know, that I could easily implement in my life. And that I try to support I have a teenage daughter, you know, to try to put her on that path, but you know how hard it is. And also Sanskrit. It was one of the most amazing classes, and I wanted to delve deeper. So now, right now, I'm taking continuing education courses in Sanskrit. So please, that's a very difficult question.
It's interesting if you're, you know, attending this webinar and maybe you're here because you are interested in the concepts of neuroscience and consciousness. Maybe you want to get into management. Maybe you are thinking of changing careers. Maybe you're hoping to balance better the career that you have with your family. Keith, Dr. Travis, or even Simone, do you feel like the concepts, the classes that you're taking here then would apply, for instance, in a high stakes meeting in a corporate environment, or when someone goes into interview for a job, this person who has this degree versus someone else who who does not have this background, how do you think that shows up in people in the world?
I could jump in on that one real quick. Yeah, it's, you know, the one thing you carry with you into any high stakes business meeting or interview or anything like that, whatever you do as a parent, as a student, as a coworker, in any relationship, what you bring is yourself ultimately and your state of consciousness. And the program here, this particular MA program, as Simone was referring to, really develops the whole person. So it develops the mind, the body, connection, all of it. And that's the most important thing, that you bring in a clarity, a confidence, intelligence, brilliance, wherever you go and whatever you do, you bring in that creativity. And so that's really what's being developed in the program. That's the program is both deeply kind of theoretical and understanding of consciousness and its role in our own lives and in the physical universe, but also a deep experiential element. So we're a real profound emphasis on self-development from within. And that means culturing the nervous system, following a wonderful Ayurvedic sort of ideal daily routine that supports all of these qualities. Regular meditation, we all meditate together, all the students and faculty, and all of these different things, yoga asanas. It's really there. It's 1 year out of your life, or 2.5 to 3 years if you're doing this online, that you can really dive deep within yourself and develop your own faculties. And then you carry those into whatever situations. Any situation is an opportunity for more growth and progress, and you bring those qualities into those environments. So I think on an experiential level and on a theoretical level, it's a fascinating program, very useful.
And I'm going back to the slide. These are the core courses. And then, and you've mentioned some of these things. There's a core course called Enlightenment. These are choices. You will take one of these two about science and creative intelligence. And then we talk about the Bhagavad Gita, and that again, I think some questions come up. How does this apply to real life? I know that Simone is very just excited about Sanskrit. And I think I mentioned in a previous webinar that 5 years ago, I don't know that Sanskrit was commented upon in regard to corporate America. And now it really is something that we're reading about in journals. So maybe Dr. Travis, tell us why these classes, the Bhagavad Gita, Sanskrit, how in 2022 is this suddenly becoming part of organizational behavior studies and what people are paying high dollars for corporate trainings and looking at key performance indicators and returns on investment in employees? And this is ancient understanding, is it not?
It is ancient, but what it's bringing is a real change in how you process the world. And this is a key point. Keith's response was just great there. And the way you bring in more of yourself into a job, into an interview, into a problem space, is you have to modify brain functioning. What he's saying is not some new affirmation that you learn to do because now you've been at MIU, but by moving the brain to transcending, where you allow the body and mind to completely settle down to inner wakefulness, coming back into activity, again, transcending, you begin to integrate this deep expansion and perspective that you have inside with everything that you do. And that's what's seen in all of the things that Keith was saying. And so Sanskrit is another one of those technologies. Sanskrit's not a conversational language like German or French or something that's used for communication. Rather, the sounds of the Ved help to connect individual thinking, the individual ego, with the universal self. And simply by floating through that sequence, not being concerned with intellectual understanding, but just speaking out the sounds, it helps to integrate your relative active thinking self with your very deep expanded being self.
And Simone, I know this became a big deal for you. You didn't see Sanskrit coming into your life. How did this just wrap you up and why?
Yeah, so when I saw in the program, when I was applying, that there was a class of Sanskrit, I remember thinking, how can I skip that? I mean, do I really need to do this? Why is this in this program? Tech neuroscience. And okay, but it was mandatory, so I had to take, and it was just mind-blowing. I'm not going to say it was mind-blowing. It was self-blowing. So let me make myself clear. So we started studying. The first 2 weeks went very well. We were learning the alphabet and everything. To the day, our professor, our dear Dr. Agnes, said that we would have a short quiz on Saturday. So on Friday, I sat down with my classmate. Dr. Travis remembers her, Ashley. I sat with Ashley to study. And each one, we would take turns reading some verses of the Bhagavad Gita, right? So as I started reading, I started crying. But it was not something that I could control. I would read and cry compulsively, right? Like unstoppably. And then Ashley would come up, she came up and she said, she hugged me, Simon, what's going on? What's happening? I don't know. I have no idea what's happening. So as soon as I would stop reading, I would also stop crying, right? And then as I started, as I started reading again, I would start crying again. So later I could understand that what was happening was that the sounds, as Dr. Travis was explaining, they were having a profound impact on my physiology in terms of release of stress or some emotional pain or some scars, if we want to use a Sanskrit term, right? So that went on for the remainder of the course. You know, I was like extremely sensitive. Nobody could say anything to me. I was like very, very fragile, so to speak, very, very vulnerable. But then I finished the course. And later on, I continued because I knew there was something there for me. So I continued my studies with Sanskrit, but from a more balanced state, since, you know, I never stopped meditating or anything. And today, the experiences that I have with Sanskrit are blissful. I can honestly say that I am totally in love with Sanskrit. And I hope Dr. Keith Wagner will bring, you know, more advanced courses, because that's where, you know, my real development is. That's where I can connect with my real self. And then, since our lives, as in, there's this saying in the Vedic literature that says that your world is as you are. So think about it. If my world is as I am, I need to work profoundly, profoundly on myself, so that I can shift my world. And now, just to connect with what you're saying about the corporate world, right? Participating in business meetings and everything. When we do this program, we need to keep really an open mind regarding our professional careers. Why? Because everything can change. Once you connect with your real self, your outer world can also change, right? So I used to be this workaholic, right? With an amazing overload of work. Today, I run our coffee business, which is going very well and gives me time to work on myself. And I also have other activities, but it's like, I don't have the level of stress that I used to have, you know, 4 or 5 years ago. You see, you need to ask me to stop talking, Sean.
No, it is perfect. And I think if you have ever looked into, you know, corporate coaches, and you know, this is very expensive. And I think Simone just made a good point. If you are an entrepreneur, this is a degree that can serve you. It's an accredited master's degree. So if you would choose, I know one of the questions that came up was, if I choose to go get a PhD at a prestigious university with a big name, does this master's degree go there. Yes, this is an accredited master's degree. And the more we look at these foundational business programs or different types of programs, you're getting these foundational courses. And Dr. Travis or Dr. Wegman, when it was interesting that Simone said something about, you know, being a workaholic and being really busy, and then all of a sudden now she's getting more done with less stress. And I know, Dr. Travis, every once in a while we get to address this. So I would like the official opinion from the scientific community. Can we multitask? Is it effective?
No. What multitasking does is it allows you to do two things, but you never do anyone deeply. You can, as long as they're middle level responsibilities, you can do them both, but you miss the implicit learning, you miss the deep insights. What Simone was experiencing is, if you identify with things outside, you're constantly feeling like you're on this treadmill, constantly going around. You go from one thing to another, to another. There's no stability. There's no evenness. When you find that stability and evenness inside, you perceive the world differently. It's called perceived stress. It's something we've seen in studies with veterans, with emergency workers, with teachers, with students, with veterans, that perceived stress goes down. When you're under stress, the frontal lobes go offline and you cannot see the bigger picture. And that's when you're completely overwhelmed. When the frontal lobes can stay on, when you have lower perceived stress, you can actually take each every experience and put it into a larger context. And because of that, you're able to deal with it in a more effective way. And what happens is life ceases to become constantly running and after the next emergency, and becomes more like running hurdles. You know you have the ability to deal with it. And you wake up in the morning and you wonder what challenge you'll get today.
And I think there are certifications. If you're on this webinar and you're checking your options, okay, I already have a bachelor's degree. And by the way, most US equivalent bachelor's degrees will qualify you for this program. So it doesn't matter what your background is, as long as your grade point average meets our requirement, you can get into this master's degree program. But maybe you were looking at a certification. That's not a master's degree. This is an accredited master's degree that stands up anywhere. And Keith, I'm going to ask you about this because psychological safety in the workplace is now a big topic. And I think from a management level, if people here are wanting to get promoted to manager, or maybe they are a manager and they're realizing, okay, new generations of workers are coming in, they have a different mindset. And it's a big thing to feel safe psychologically at work, bringing in your whole self, whether you identify as male or you identify as female, all kinds of things are happening. How do you think a master's degree in CHP is going to help someone in the workplace as things are really evolving, and it can give them some staying power, right?
Yeah, absolutely. No, you as everybody can kind of sense here, you really develop the whole self in this program. And that means all aspects of yourself, physical, mental, emotional. Meditating, transcending, allowing the mind to settle down deeply within twice a day is a way to not only gain deep rest and relieve tremendous amount of stress, and in fact, dissolve stress from your life, but it's also more profoundly a way to expand the mind and develop your inner potential. And so each time you meditate, which is, this is a factored in part of this program, I think what makes it so unique and so special, is that when you're meditating twice a day, you're actually researching consciousness. It's a part of the academic study. You're researching yourself. You're discovering the values of consciousness that exist within you. And so you're bringing out more and more of who you are. It's like Maharishi always would say, you water the root and you enjoy the fruit. So when you water a plant, the plant flourishes on all levels, just from that simple activity, just by taking care of that sort of fundamental. So all of this, all of these values, the psychology of the workplace, human potential, human performance in the workplace, intellectual, creative flexibility, adaptability, all these features, because the world's always changing. And no matter what stage you are in life, you really need the ability to adapt, learn new skills. All of these things are wonderful sort of byproducts, like side effects of the program, that you gain this sort of mental, emotional flexibility and profound development towards higher states of consciousness. And then again, you just carry that into any situation, and it brings more and more of who you are from within. And so your authentic inner self comes out, shines through, and that produces results. I mean, everybody knows from their own experience, when you're feeling good, when you're feeling happy, you're feeling confident, that just sort of flows over into your activities and influences all your whole surroundings. So it's a wonderful byproduct of the program. Not only do you gain this profound, deep knowledge of the connection and between inner development and the release of stress and all these different things, but you actually practically develop that every day.
And Dr. Travis, we want to not lose our edge. I think that's part of it too. The workplace continues to be competitive to some level, but maybe soften our edges. So, and I think a lot of us look at maybe sports metaphors or whatever, musicians, sports folks get to this level of transcendence. Do you feel like the skills again and that we acquire from exploring consciousness will allow people to still be competitive in the workplace and still continue to succeed?
Yes, they'll continue to compete, but it won't be by pushing others down. Because as you transcend, you realize that you're part of a larger system. You're not an individual, isolated billiard ball just rolling around the organization as it is. But rather, you're part of a larger system. And so what you will do is your actions will actually be to support everyone. Abraham Maslow called this, is it growth motivation or is it deficiency motivation? Do you do things because you feel a lack in yourself, or you do things that you want to grow? The models that you get allow you to see this larger picture intellectually. The experiences you have during your meditation practice, reading Sanskrit, yoga asana practice, you actually experience that the world is your family, you're part of a larger whole. And so someone going into a company and everyone is meditating, it'll look like any other company. Everyone is focusing on things and they're sending reports. But the difference is everyone's thinking of everyone else, and everyone's thinking that I succeed when the company succeeds. And that's not a new affirmation that the CEO has sent down with a recent memo. It's actually the direct experience you have.
And we're seeing, you know, major companies have meditation rooms and space for meditation. Simone, I would love to ask you, because you, again, have experienced the online student experience and the on-campus mm-hmm. student experience, and folks can decide what will work best for them. But if there's somebody wondering, because we get this is a commitment of your time, of your money, do you have anything to say to somebody if they're wondering, okay, is my life actually going to be better if I invest in this versus if I don't?
Well, for sure. Life will really, really improve with this program. The benefits embrace both a person's personal and professional lives. And what I see is that life actually becomes easier because we access, like we said before, our own self. And we access a level of intelligence that organizes the whole universe, that organizes all life forms on the planet, including humans, including people's lives. Because the way we are raised, we see ourselves as separate from everything else. And for that, we need to stand out, we need to be better, we need to compete more and more. However, when we align with this level of intelligence, which organizes all levels of life on the planet, we see that we, like Dr. Travis was saying, we see that we can cooperate, we can collaborate more, right? We can live from a much lower level of stress and still accomplish a level of fulfillment that we'll not find just doing our regular run-of-the-mill things. Actually, I think this is an important point because we usually look for fulfillment outside ourselves. And we look for fulfillment through our work, our status, social status, financial status, family, and everything. And actually, as we connect, as we transcend, we find the fulfillment first, and then we experience life, and then we express ourselves in life. And talking about my experience in the on-campus program, I felt that firsthand. Why? Because when I went, I live in Brazil, when I went to the United States, I left my husband, I left my house in Brazil, and I just went with my teenage daughter, right? But I lived there, I lived in Fairfield, apart from her. So I lived at the MIU door, and she lived at the Maharshi School door. So she was taking, you know, her life separately from me. And what I noticed was, who am I? Nobody in my family needed me. Our family business didn't need me. So in the beginning, I was a little lost, right? Because I was not playing any of the roles that I used to play in life. So at that point, that was actually a challenge, but it turned out to be a great teaching because I was able to find my own fulfillment, my own realization with myself apart, not depending on anyone for that. Right.
Right. And I think that's what we're seeing with, you know, if 2020 and 2021 taught us nothing, maybe you did, you know, maybe you were displaced from your job. Maybe you did spend a whole lot more time with your immediate family members than you ever imagined possible. I think that this, and I see people kind of shaking their heads, yes. This master's degree in consciousness and human potential, and you can learn more about it on our website and what the classes are, will help you to have those tools to, again, whether you're staying in your same job, maybe come at it from another direction, maybe you're changing careers, maybe you are now in an empty nest position and you want to say, okay, what do I want to do now? Or maybe you are at the beginning stages, maybe you've just finished a BA. We have students of all different ages. We have on-campus housing, regardless of your age or position, you know, in your life stage, or we have off-campus housing. So you can find things in Fairfield to work for you or with you. We do have jobs are in the area. You can talk with your admissions counselor. And I do want to just ask a couple of questions. So I want to clarify. Everyone practices transcendental meditation, and you can learn more about that even on our website, but it does help with peak performance and personal development. The next entry is in August, so you can join us on campus or online. There's that email, admissions@miu.edu, if we somehow didn't answer your question or you think of something later. It is an accredited program. This is not a certification. This is a master's degree, so you can use student loans. If you're wondering about financial aid, you can actually go. We have a website, miu.edu/webinars, and click on the replay button. And if you want to email financial aid, there's their email. There's also a replay there. It's actually me running around Fairfield. But you can see Fairfield, I go to the reservoir, I talk about our sustainability, and we have solar power that powers a great deal of our university. So if you're thinking about coming on campus, there's a webinar about that, and there's where it is on that page. So you'll just see where that red arrow is, click replays. If you think of something later, after the webinar is over, go to miu.edu and our live chatters are there. They will answer your questions. If you want to get more in depth, you can go to miu.edu and there's a little button that says visit. You can set up an even more in-depth visit and go over this. You can see kind of where at the top of the page there is visit, and there's also the apply button. And the reason I bring that to your attention is if you apply now, it doesn't mean you have to come. It means you want more information and you're very interested and you want to start that process. But if you decide fall entry doesn't work for you and you want to defer till spring, till February, you can. If you want to wait, maybe it isn't going to work at all. We understand. But because this is at the forefront of what's happening now, I know we're talking about vulnerability in the workplace, the most Successful leaders are those who have now these soft skills, and that's what people are looking for. Soft skills are what this degree, the MA in Consciousness and Human Potential, is all about. So we have actually come to the end of our time here. I want to again thank everyone behind the scenes, Dr. Travis and Dr. Wegman and Simone. As we become more of a global workplace, we are a global community, and we'd love to see you obviously on campus in Fairfield, Iowa. But we'd also, if online works for you, or if you want to start online and join us on campus later, please do check us out at miu.edu, and we're happy to answer any further questions you have. Thanks for joining the webinar. MIU is a nonprofit university accredited by the Higher Learning Commission. Financial aid is available for most students.